Hello students, welcome to the video lessons of University Physics, Electricity and Magnetism. This lecture is about the chapter inductance, that is your chapter 30. This is the lecture 9 of this lecture series and the first lecture of the chapter inductance. So in this lecture, we'll discuss about self-inductance and magnetic field energy. And hope you have viewed the last video. In the last video lesson, that is in chapter 29, about electromagnetic induction. Okay. So electromagnetic induction means what? Your electric field is induced by magnetic field. Or actually you can say whenever there is a change in magnetic flux, an EMF is induced, which is your Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. So you know this thing. So in this chapter, first, we'll discuss about self-inductance. So that means, what do you mean by this self-inductance? That means something is induced by self. So that means here, in electromagnetic induction, you know that your magnetic flux, that means there is a, whenever there is a change in magnetic flux, and EMF is generated. Or you can say also there is a current. That means change in magnetic flux generates EMF. But here we'll discuss how a current itself induced EMF or induced a current. Okay. So that means here we'll discuss whenever a current is flowing, how it can induce a EMF, or you can say another induced current. So this is your self inductance. Now let us discuss how it is possible. So all of you know that when a current is present in a circuit, it sets up a magnetic field. Or you know that a current or moving charge creates a magnetic field. And whenever there is a magnetic field, there is a magnetic flux. But now think, suppose the current changes with time. So suppose initially the current is I, then gradually it increases. Then this I creates a magnetic field and there is a magnetic flux. So when you increase the current, there is an increase in the magnetic field and there is an increase in the magnetic flux. So that means whenever there is a varying current, there is a varying magnetic flux, or there is a varying magnetic flux. And whenever there is a varying magnetic flux, an EMF is induced. So this is known as what? Self-induced EMF. Because here, the current, the varying current induces an EMF. That means the current itself induced a current. Yeah, of course, here the current should vary with time. Okay, so this is known as self-induced EMF. And what is self-inductance? The circuit or circuit element. Or you can say the property of this circuit element, which due to which the self-induced EMF is induced, you can say this is your self inductance. Or you can define it like that, the property of a coil, because generally this happens in a coil, the property of a coil which opposes the change in current in it is known as self inductance. Yeah. Now what is this which opposes the change in current? Here what we have discussed, whenever there is a varying current, there is a varying magnetic flux and this creates a EMF. If you recall Lenz's law, then what is this law? The effect opposes the cause. So here also the self-induced EMF opposes the cause. But is here which is the cause? The cause is not the current, but the change in current. So that means here the self-induced EMF opposes the change in current. So that's why you define a quantity, physical quantity, which is your self inductance and due to which the coil opposes the change in current in it. Like your resistance. What is resistance? You can say it is a parameter which opposes the flow of current. If you say the wire is having this much of resistance, that means what? This resistance opposes the flow of current in the wire. And inductance, self-inductance, or you can say simply inductance. And inductance opposes the rate of change in current. So this is the difference. Inductance opposes the rate of change in current. Okay. How can you define the inductance or self-inductance? This is also known as only inductance. So inductance is given as A high B Y I. As I have told that, generally this property is observed in a coil. So accordingly, it is defined L equal to N phi B by I. N is what? Number of turns of the coil. Phi B is the magnetic flux linked with the coil and I is the current. That means whenever the current is I, this is phi B and the inductance is L. And it is a constant quantity for a particular coil, because if you increase I, accordingly phi B increases. So L equal to N phi B by I. What is the unit of inductance? So from these definition also you can find the unit of inductance in terms of Weber and Ampere. But generally the unit of inductance is Henry. Okay, so it is known as Henry. Now let us find out what is the value of the self-induced EMF in terms of inductance. Okay, so now what you define, what is inductance? L equal to N phi B by I. And you know that here the current varies with time. When the current varies with time, also the magnetic flux varies with time. So you can write this as what? L variation of current with time. That is L di by dt is equal to N d phi B by dt. But what is this N d phi B by dt? Already we have discussed Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction. Here also let us discuss it again. What is this law? So mathematically you can write EMF is minus N d phi B by dt. It may be a self-induced EMF, whatever may be. Whenever there is a change in magnetic flux, EMF is induced, and this would be equal to minus N d phi B by dt. Now this compare this two. If you compare this, now what is the value of self-induced EMF in terms of inductance? Minus L di by dt. Minus L di by dt. Or also in other words, you can say that according to Lenz's law, whatever may be the value, thus EMF, it should opposes the change in current, because it is the effect, it is the cause. So E should be proportional to di by dt. As it opposes, there is a negative sign. So you can write E equal to some constant of proportionality into di by dt. This constant of proportionality is known as L. Likewise, you are saying V proportional to I. If you remember Ohm's law, then V equal to IR. R is a constant of proportionality. It is known as resistance. Similarly, here you can say that here the EMF, induced EMF, is proportional to di by dt. Obviously, if the rate of change in current is more, EMF is more. But here a negative sign is there because it opposes this change in current. Okay. So then how can you define your also? What is inductance? Quantitatively, how can you define this? So you can define the inductance or self-inductance as the magnitude of self-induced EMF per unit rate of change of current. the magnitude of self-induced EMF per unit rate of change in current. Okay, so this is the value of inductance and the self-induced EMF. Just we have discussed that inductance, it is a property of a coil, you are saying, and this is the coil. So you are quite acquainted with the name choke, coil and inductor. This coil or choke also is known as inductor. And if you come across any electrical circuit, there is a resistor, there is a capacitor, there is a inductor. So now let us see, what is this inductor? What's the use of this inductor? You know self-inductance and self-induced EMF. Now let us discuss about inductor. So inductor as a circuit element. So this is the inductor. Generally, we name it as L, and this is the circuit symbol. Likewise, your capacitance, you name it as C, resistance R, and inductor is L. Resistor is R, capacitor is C, inductor is L. That means it is having inductance L. Okay, so this is a inductor and it is present near circuit, but I is the current flowing through the circuit. And obviously it is a variable current. And the EMF is a variable source of EMF. So, how can you define that inductor? It is nothing but it is a circuit device that is designed to have a particular inductance. See, your wire is there. And generally, when you consider a simple wire, it is having resistance. But here this inductance is very less. That's why generally the inductor is in the form of this, in the form of a coil always. This is also known as choke. Sorry, this is the circuit symbol of inductor as I have told. So now what is the use of it? Why you are using this? As just we have discussed, when there is a self-induced EMF in the inductor, this self-induced EMF opposes the change in current. So that means you can say the use of the inductor is to oppose the change in current. So here we can say an inductor in a direct current circuit helps to maintain a steady current despite any fluctuations in the applied EMF. So that means it opposes what? The fluctuation in the current. But when you consider an alternating circuit, there is a variation in current, but an inductor tends to suppress the variations of the current that are more rapid. Actually, what should be the variation? If it is more rapid, then it suppresses this. Okay, so this is the use of the inductor. So another thing is that as the inductor is present and here due to the variation of magnetic field, there is a self-induced EMF. So obviously, whenever an inductor is present, it should store some energy like the capacitor. So now let us see what energy is stored in the inductor. Yeah. So before going to the energy stored in inductor, first let us find out what is the potential difference across the inductor. So we have discussed just what is the EMF induced in the inductor. Now let us find out what is the potential difference across the ends of the inductor. Like your resistor, it is V equal to IR. Similarly, what is in case of inductor? Here two important things we have defined. One is EC. It's the conservative electric field produced by charges distributed around the circuit. You are acquainted with this because in the chapters of electricity, we have discussed this electric field is conservative. So now here, another electric field is there, which is your non-conservative induced electric field. Because a current is flowing, so there is an electric field. But due to variation of the current, whenever there is a induced electric field, there is also induced current, there is an induced electric field. Let it be EN. So here C stands for conservative, N for non-conservative. But whatever may be inside the inductor, the electric field must be zero because the same current is flowing throughout the circuit at a particular time. So the total electric field within the inductor must be zero. Okay. Now we know that what is the induced EMF value? You know that. What is the induced EMF? Minus L di by dt. And you know that how can you write the EMF in terms of electric field? EMF is En dot dl. So this is integration A to B. So two sides of the inductor you are taking as A and B. So A to B integration En dl equal to minus L di by dt. Okay. So now, as the total electric field in the inductor is zero, what is EC plus En? EC plus En should be equal to zero. Or what is EC? It should be equal to minus En. So you can write what is EC dot dl A to B. This is L di by dt. But what is EC dot dl? It is nothing but the potential of point A with respect to point B, or you can say this is the potential difference across the inductor. So here two important things you have to keep it in mind. The induced EMF is minus L di by dt, but the voltage across the inductor is L di by dt. Because when we'll discuss about different circuits, circuits containing resistor, inductor, circuits containing resistor, capacitor and inductor, this part will be very much important. So the voltage across the inductor, or you can say that the potential difference across the inductor is L di by dt. Okay. Now let us find out what is the energy stored. Here I have mentioned one thing, that magnetic energy stored in an inductor. It is obvious, because in the inductor, due to variation of current, a magnetic field is produced. Due to the current, due to variation, the magnetic field varies. As when the magnetic field varies, and obviously some energy is stored, then what is this energy? This energy is nothing but magnetic energy. Just we have to find out what is this magnetic energy. What is the magnitude of this magnetic energy? Okay. So, one thing it should be clear, that when you consider an inductor, we are considering what? It is having negligible resistance. Okay. So, no energy is dissipated within the inductor. So, only you can say that magnetic energy is stored. But what is the value? So just you discuss what is the voltage across the inductor. Voltage across the inductor is L di by dt. Yeah. And this is the voltage across the inductor. Then what is the power supply? So obviously when you say that a current I is flowing and the current increases, means that is a supplied source, external source, which supply this current to the inductor. So if at any instant of time the potential difference across the ends of the inductor is L di by dt, so what is the power supplied? All of you know that power is what? Voltage into current, or potential difference into current. Here also the power is what? VAB into I. So that means VAB is what? L di by dt. So power is LI di by dt. So at any instant of time, the power supplied to the inductor is Li di by dt. Now what is the energy supply? So now let us consider a small time dt. Power is what? Energy per unit time. So that means you can say energy supplied per unit time is what? Li di by dt. So energy supplied in time dt is, let it be designated as du. So du is Li di, because this is P into dt. So this is Li di by dt into dt, so Li di. So that means energy supplied during a small time interval dt is Li di. When the also current change, current increases to a small value di. Now suppose throughout the process, when the current increases from 0 to a maximum value, here we have taken capital I. What will be the energy stored? That means we have considered a case in a circuit whenever an inductor is there and a power supply is there, and we are increasing the current from 0 to capital I. Now, what is the energy stored in the total process? The energy stored is LIdI integration 0 to I, which is equal to half LI square. This is in the form of magnetic energy. So, you can say that the energy stored in an inductor is nothing but half LI square. Okay. So, this is the energy stored in an inductor. So, now let us find out what is the energy stored per unit volume. Then you will be clear. It is nothing but the magnetic energy. Let us find out what is the energy stored per unit volume. To know this energy stored per unit volume, you should know the volume of the inductor. So that means you should take a particular inductor so you can know that. So let us here take a particular inductor, then we generalize. Because finally you will observe that the energy stored per unit volume only depends upon the magnetic field and permeability. Now let us here consider a toroidal cylinder. So don't be confused. Sorry, toroidal solenoid. What is a toroidal solenoid? So the solenoid in this form. Solenoid, you know that when the solenoid is in this form, it is known as a toroidal solenoid. Carefully observe the figure. So it is a toroidal solenoid with cross-sectional area A. See, this is the cross-sectional area A and mean radius R. And mean radius R. This is the radius. And it closely wound with N turns of wire on a non-magnetic core. This is important, non-magnetic core. As here, we are considering the solenoid where there is a change in current, and due to this change in current there is a magnetic field. We should consider a non-magnetic coil to form the solenoid, because if it is a magnetic non-magnetic core, sorry, if you consider this as a magnetic, or you take a magnetic core, then what will happen? The magnetic core is having its own magnetic field, so then it is very difficult to find the magnetic field due to the a current flowing through these wires. So it should be a non-magnetic core. Okay. Now let us find out what is the energy stored in that inductor. Then what is the energy stored per unit volume? You know that energy stored in an inductor is what? Half Li square. Let at a time the current I is flowing. So in that case, when the current is I, let us say the maximum current is I, if you say, then let us find out what is the energy stored. So to know the energy stored, you should know what is the value of inductance, or you can say self inductance. From the definition of the self inductance, you know that L is what? N phi B by I. Okay. And here, what is phi B? What is the magnetic flux linked? You know Ampere's law? Using Ampere's law, you can find out what is the magnetic field whenever a current is I is flowing through this solenoid. And what is the magnetic flux, magnetic field into this cross-sectional area? Then you can find L. So the all of you know that the magnetic flux due to a solenoid is, this type of solenoid is mu 0 ni by 2 pi mu 0 ni by 2 pi r. This is very simple, because you know that B dot dl integration is mu 0 I, and when there is a n number of terms, it is B dot dl integration is mu 0 ni. What is B dl integration? As B is a uniform, B into 2 pi r. B into 2 pi r is mu 0 ni. So B is what? Mu 0 ni by 2 pi r. Then what is phi b? Phi b is b into a, so mu 0 ni a by 2 pi r. So you get phi b. N is the number of turns. This is I. So what is L? Mu 0 n square a by 2 pi r. This is what? This is the self inductance. But you have to find out what is the energy stored. Then find out what is the energy stored. U equal to Li square. Half Li square. So half mu 0 n square a by 2 pi r I square. Then what is the energy density? Energy density means what? Energy stored per unit volume. What is the volume of this energy? This length is what? This 2 pi r, because this radius is r, so the length is 2 pi r. This is the cross-sectional area A. So what is the volume? 2 pi r into A. So as the volume is 2 pi r into A, so the energy density per unit volume is this U by 2 pi r A. So the energy we are taking capital U and the energy density as small u. So small u is U by 2 pi r A. So half mu 0 n square I square by 2 pi r square. Because already 2 pi r is there, again this is 2 pi r. But already you know that what is b? B is mu 0 n I by 2 pi r. So if you substitute this, then simply we can get the energy density u is half b square by mu 0 or b square by 2 mu 0. So you can generalize this expression as this is the magnetic energy density in matter. Because here you see, it doesn't depend upon the shape and size of the solenoid, the energy density. It depends only on the magnetic field, of course, and the mu 0. And of course, the magnetic field depends upon how much current is flowing, the number of turns itself. So that means if you know the magnetic field, then you can find what is the energy density. So energy density is b square by 2 mu 0. If you have remembered what is the energy density in a parallel plate capacitor, the energy density in a parallel plate capacitor is half epsilon 0 e square. Here it is b square by 2 mu 0. B is what? Magnetic field induction vector or magnetic flux density. And if you write B equal to mu 0 H, then also you'll get the same thing, half mu 0 H square. Electric field energy is half epsilon 0 E square, your half mu 0 H square. But however, when you write in terms of B, this is B square by 2 mu 0. So this is about the energy stored in an inductor and the energy density. You can say magnetic field energy density. Now you are clear. As we are representing the energy density as B square by 2 mu 0, this is the magnetic energy. So that means now you are sure that your inductor stores energy like the capacitor. Capacitor stores electrical energy. An inductor stores magnetic energy. Now let us test how much you have understood. And this is a very simple problem regarding the induced EMF in an inductor. So the question is, rank the following inductors in order of potential difference from most positive to most negative. In each case, the inductor has zero resistance and the current flows from point A through the inductor to the point B. So here, you have to rank in order of potential difference, not the induced EMF. Because you know that the induced EMF is minus L di by dt and potential difference is only L di by dt. So first is the current through a 2 microhenry inductor increases from 1 ampere to 2 ampere in 0.5 second. Next is the current through a 4 microhenry inductor, which decreases from 3 to ampere to 0 in 2 second. The current through a 1 microhenry inductor, which remains constant at 4 ampere. The current through a 1 microhenry inductor increases from 0 to 4 in 0.25 second. That means in each case it is mentioned how the current changes and what is the time. So easily you can find out what is di by dt in each case. If you see in the third case, what is happening? The current remains constant. The third case, the potential difference across the inductor is zero. And the second case, the current decreases. So your potential difference is negative. So in the first case and fourth case, it is positive. Let us find out which is more. If you calculate, in the first case, it is 4 microvolt. As I have told, second case, the current decreases. So it is minus 6 microvolt. In the third case, the current remains constant. So it is 0. And in the fourth case, it is 16 microvolt. Now, it is obvious. This is more in fourth. So if you rank it past your 4, then 1, then 3, then 2. So here it is very simple. Just to calculate what is the potential difference, then write it in order. So now let us consider another. Here it is mentioned the current in a solenoid is reversed in direction while keeping the same magnitude. Yeah, that means the current in a solenoid is reversed in direction while keeping the same magnitude. Does this change the magnetic field within the solenoid? Does this change the magnetic energy density in the solenoid? Yeah, one thing is that, so first a current is going in the solenoid. We are considering the magnetic, not induced EMF, nothing. So whenever there is a current, there is a magnetic field. So when the current changes direction, then what will happen? All of you know that there will be the change in the direction of magnetic field. So what is the answer to this question? It should be yes. Because the magnitude of magnetic field doesn't change, but the magnetic field changes as its direction change. And the second one is, does this change the magnetic energy density in the solenoid? No. Because the magnitude of the magnetic field doesn't change. What is the magnetic energy density? B square by 2 mu 0. When you consider B square, it is magnitude by. So what is happening? So the magnetic field energy density remains same. There is no change. But the magnetic field changes as the direction change. Let us work out a problem. And in this case, you have to find out the self-induced EMF. If the current in a toroidal solenoid increases uniformly for 0 to 6 ampere in 3 microseconds, find the magnitude and direction of the self-induced EMF. Okay, now let us find out. If the current changes, how much it changes? 0 to 6 ampere. So change in current is positive. So your di by dt is, that means positive. So and what is di by dt? 2 into 10 to the power 6 ampere per second. What is the magnitude of the induced EMF? L di by dt, this is 80 volt. Okay. So here, but as actually what is induced EMF? Minus L di by dt. So EMF is negative. So generally here, the direction of the current or EMF is, you can say as EMF is negative, it is clockwise. Okay. So this is the magnitude and direction of the induced EMF. So, this is about the first lecture of this chapter, inductance. So, let me brief what we have discussed in this chapter. In this chapter, just you have discussed what is inductance, or you can say self-inductance, And another thing is, what is an inductor and what is the energy stored in the inductor and what is the magnetic energy density. This is the end of this lecture, and in the next lecture of this chapter we'll discuss about RL circuit. Already we have discussed about in electricity chapters RC circuit, resistance capacitor circuit. Here we'll discuss what is RC circuit. Whenever there is a resistance, sorry, RL circuit, resistance and inductor in a circuit, what happens? So the next lecture we'll discuss in detail the RL circuit. Then accordingly we'll continue LC circuit, then RLC circuit and all that. And I hope you will go through all the lessons and you try to understand each and every bit. Thank you.